The Old Testament reading is the 26th Psalm. Vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity, and I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and mind, for your steadfast love is before my eyes, and I walk in faithfulness to you. I do not sit with the worthless, nor do I consort with hypocrites. I hate the company of evildoers and will not sit with the wicked. I wash my hands in innocence and go around your altar, O Lord, singing aloud a song of thanksgiving and telling all your wondrous deeds. O Lord, I love the house in which you dwell and the place where your glory abides. Do not sweep me away with sinners, nor my life with the bloodthirsty, those in whose hands are evil devices and whose right hands are full of bribes. But as for me, I walk in my integrity. Redeem me and be gracious to me. My foot stands on level ground. In the great congregation, I will bless the Lord. The epistle reading is from the 12th chapter of Romans, beginning with verse 9. Marks of the true Christian. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The gospel lesson is the 16th chapter of Matthew, beginning with verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. The word of the Lord.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. This chapter of the Gospel, as I said last week, begins with the clarification of who Jesus is. You will remember that in the scene preceding the one read for you today, Peter answers the question, "Who do you say that I am?" by saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." In the second pericope that you heard read for you today, Jesus goes on beyond that statement of who he is to how he is. How he is to be the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. And for us, as he speaks to us through the scripture, he uses this powerful little word that I shared with the children today. That word must, M-U-S-T, a four-letter word. Human beings don't like that word must, do we? When we're told we must do something, I think it is an innate response for us to sort of bristle and say, "Oh yeah? Who says?" I mean, that was the case in the garden when sin entered the world. God said, "This is all for you except for one thing." And of course, our father and mother, Adam and Eve, said, "Oh yeah? Who says? What do you mean we must not eat of the fruit? What do you mean? Who are you? Do you think you're God or something?" Because God was God. Jesus in this section discloses that the Son of Man, the Christ, he must go to Jerusalem. He must suffer many things. He must die. He must, on the third day, be resurrected from the dead. That's the first and powerful section in this portion of scripture that we heard today. This is Jesus' must. Well, you can understand the political reality of it all, can't you? I mean, he's going to go to Jerusalem. The whole tribe is there in Jerusalem. You have the Sanhedrin, and he's threatening in his speaking truth to power their economics by their control and mismanagement of the temple. They're out to get him. They will hold an illegal meeting just to prove the point of their power. They want him dead. The Pharisees will be there, the ones that he's probably closest to theologically, but not exactly in concert with them. And in speaking theological correction to them, he's embarrassed them and their hubris has suffered. They'll be there. They want him dead. The Essenes will be there. The Zealots will be there. And Jesus hasn't endorsed their political agenda. They want him dead. And of course, Rome. Rome will be there. And they want peace and power. And any disturbance within that occupied territory, well, it means that Rome is feeling threatened. And ultimately, they will want him dead. But Jesus' statement about he must return to Jerusalem, he must suffer many things, he must die, he must be resurrected, is not founded or grounded in worldly things. It's founded and grounded in spiritual things. He is keenly aware that the role of Messiah is delineated in the Old Testament in Isaiah 53, and that he is to present himself blameless unto the Father, and he will be sacrificed. He will be sacrificed for the cause of God's pure love for a sinful, fallen world. Theologians long dispute what it means for him to be crucified on the cross. Some say that it's the substitutionary theory of the atonement, that he takes away the sin of the world in his sacrifice. Some say he's presenting the moral example. Some say all sorts of things. The bottom line is, we know this. We know that what he does is effective, and we know that it is a must. What he does is a must for God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Have you ever said to your kids, or remembering back to your childhood, thought about that time when you questioned your parent or your kids questioned you? Why do I have to do that? You know that one? Because I'm the Father, that's why. That's one of the best theological arguments I know. Because Isaiah says that this must happen, because God says this must happen, because Jesus says that four-letter word must. It must happen. And so it does. And for us as Christians, the cross becomes the central symbol of our faith. The cross informs our understanding of faith and theology. The cross that Jesus must turn to and die on becomes for us the ultimate reality of redemption, the ultimate reality of our salvation. For us in our tradition, that cross is empty, because as part of that must, it's not just that Christ must suffer, must go to Jerusalem, must die, but that Christ must be risen. Christ must be resurrected. And so the cross is empty, because the victory is won for us in this must that is fulfilled for us by Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That is our salvation. That is our surety. That is our confidence. It's like that old hymn, we serve a risen Savior. He lives, he lives. You know that one. But today I would be remiss if I didn't also point to you the second portion. The second portion of the scripture that was read for us. Peter, who just did so brilliantly in confessing his faith in Christ, he pulls Jesus aside and rebukes him. That word rebuke is a pretty strong word. I mean, he chews him out. God forbid it, Jesus. I don't like where you're going with this, Jesus. And that one who was so apostolically wonderful confessing his faith, Jesus speaks to him in even stronger language, get behind me, Satan. You're considering the things of the world, not spiritual things. You're becoming a stumbling block. Wow. And then he says, Peter, if you finally get it and understand this must, guess what it means for you and the fellows? It also means that as you follow me, as you get behind me and follow me, guess what, Peter? You must, there's that word again, you must take up your cross and follow me. You must be willing to, in Christ's love, share the good news. You must be willing to care for the disadvantaged of the world. You must care about the hungry. You must care about peace. You must speak the word of salvation to power. And guess what? Just as it was for me, sometimes they're going to hang you up here too. You must. You must take up your cross and follow me. Two words. The first word is appreciation. Today, as Christian people, we gather to appreciate Jesus Christ, who took up his cross, suffered, died, and arose for us. Second word, service. As we move towards Rally Day, may we remember the musts of the Christian faith. And may we, confident in Christ's power, Christ's call, Christ's love, may we take up our crosses May we follow Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.